the feet of Jesus and later pray together with one accord. We welcome those of you who are on live stream also. Welcome you. Tonight we're going to be in the Gospel of John, the 4th chapter, verses 31 through 34. This will be our 50th exposition of this book. Now, in our text tonight, two worlds collide. One's seen, one's not seen. One's above, one's beneath. One can be touched, one can't be touched. One's visible, one's invisible. One's temporal, one's eternal. Satan is the god of one, the lower. God is the god of the other, even though he presides over both. Now these two worlds, or two domains, or two environments, are not compatible. They're both intended to be inhabited. They're habitable environments where personalities live. It's more than things, and their personalities are in both realms. But they can't hold dominion at the same time. Yes. To the individual, to these personalities, only one of these worlds can hold a dominion or be most prominent. Both of them culture a certain way of thinking, a certain manner of thinking. But the manner of thinking characterizes both of these domains. But they're not harmonious ways of thinking. They're at variance with one another. And the nourishment from the higher realm supersedes the nourishment from the lower realm. Now, if a person can recognize these distinctions and accept them, they'll be able to live victoriously. If they can't, they'll be defeated and dominated by hostile powers. They'll be overwhelmed, they'll be confused, they'll be subverted. And they'll be made, because of their ignorance, to live outside the circumference of the will of God. Now, they can't remain neutral, sitting in between these worlds, occupy a neutral position. Just by their nature, they compel the person to make a choice, that one or this one. And every person makes the choice. No person fails to make a choice. See, that proves to you that man wasn't created free. Here's a situation where man is forced to make a choice. He cannot be neutral. He can't wait to make a choice. As soon as he becomes conscious or discernible, he makes a choice. All of this, of course, involves making this choice and maintaining the choice that's made. That maybe it's it. We should add that also. Once the choice is made, the choice has to be maintained. You can't vacillate back and forth. Yeah. I mean, you can try, but it's disastrous. Vacillation belongs to the lower realm, not the upper realm. All of this, maintaining this, involves the good fight of faith, laying hold on eternal life, walking in the Spirit, working out your own salvation with fear and trembling, running the race with patience set before you. See, all of that involves this daily making of choice, deciding who am I going to follow, God or Satan?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
What world am I going to live for, this world or that world? See, every day is filled with, who knows, thousands of decisions you have to make. But the making of those decisions is what working out your salvation, that's what it is. It's making these necessary choices. So we're going to see this in this text. John 4. Yes, 31 to 34. In the mean, while his disciples prayed him, saying, Master, eat. But he said unto them, I have meat to eat that ye know not of. Therefore said the disciples one to another, Hath any man brought him aught to eat? Jesus saith unto them, My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. They didn't understand that saying at the time. In the mean, verse 31, in the mean, some versions read, in the meantime, or in the meanwhile, or meanwhile, or while this was taking place, or in between, or while this was happening. The word is translated in the mean has this lexical definition, between or in the midst, meanwhile, of space between, in the middle of time between whiles, meanwhile. Now, this is descriptive of the period of time between the woman going into the city and coming back. That time in between that was the mean, or meanwhile. This was not just a time of waiting in the mean. Why not just a time of waiting? Both heaven and earth are going to work in this in between space of time. Because of this, minds are working and mouths will speak in the mean, in between. What looks like a dead zone, it's not a dead zone at all. There was an established purpose that was being worked out in the mean, in the meanwhile, in between. God's purpose was being worked out. The initial work had been done as Jesus talked to the woman. Now the work's going to be brought to completion. And until that happens, it's in the mean. Jesus knew what was taking place. The disciples didn't know what was taking place in the meanwhile. These meanwhile periods proved to be the undoing of many souls. This is the period of time that foolish virgins, that's when they fell, in the meanwhile. See,
that's right. Amen.
In the meanwhile. See, this is the undoing of many people. Mm-hmm. In between highs and lows, in between a perceived work is being done and one is being completed. In the meanwhile. It's the undoing of many people, like the five foolish virgins. See, the meanwhile lasted longer than they thought it was going to last.
That's right.
We're in the meanwhile. We're living in the meanwhile. In between when Jesus left and he's coming back. This is the meanwhile. So that's why it's lasted a couple thousand years already. In the meanwhile. This is the time you work out your salvation, fear and trembling, in the meanwhile.
Amen.
The meanwhile time. Now you can't, this is the liability of being inordinately attached to entertainment and ease. This is the danger. Because these both happen in the meanwhile. In the period of times in between. The world has figured out some things you could do to keep you real busy. In the meanwhile. You got to watch out for that. Now, nobody can make up a list of rules of what you do at the meanwhile. Yeah. Nobody can tell you what to do. You have to determine what you're going to do, because you're stuck in the meanwhile. Yeah, and the meanwhile is when you get ready. That's where you get ready, in the meanwhile. Yeah. You don't get ready at the beginning. You don't get ready at the end. You get ready in the meanwhile. Yeah. See, that's when you get ready. I hope you can. I know you have confidence you can see this, but it's very important. And you can't intrude into someone else's meanwhile and tell them what to do. You got all you can do to handle your meanwhile. But it's got to be handled now. It's got to be handled. When you're young, if you learn to diddle around all the time, and there's the world will teach you to do this. If your parents don't guide you, this is what the kids will do. Yes. They'll learn to waste the meanwhiles. When they grow up, they won't know what to do with meanwhiles. Mm-hmm. My parents, they never let us have much meanwhile. If I was idle, right off the bat, I was given something to do. And they could tell when I was pretending when I was pretending to be busy. They could tell. But I lived to thank God for that. I didn't have to learn that after I was a mature man. I'm thank God for that. Learning to manage the meanwhiles. The disciples thought at this time that this was a good time to eat. That's what they thought. They bought something back for Jesus to eat because he was wearied with the journey. Remember, it says he was wearied with the journey. He sat on the well of Jacob. He was wearied with the journey, so they thought this is a good time to eat. They were probably like some of Jesus' relatives, which turned out to be his mother and his brothers, who went down to get him where he was preaching and teaching because they thought he was beside himself. He kind of went off into Looney Tunes. Because he was so absorbed with the work of God, they thought he was beside himself. But, you know, he went a little nuts for a while. That's what they thought. And they called him to come out, and Jesus wouldn't go out. He wouldn't go out. This is his mother we're talking about. And his brothers, he wouldn't go out. Like he said, you want to talk to me? You got to come in. I'm not going out. He was in the meanwhile. He knew what to do, see, meanwhile. So they said, Master, eat. Other versions say, Rabbi, eat. Eat something. Master, take some food. Rabbi, have something to eat. Teacher, eat something. The disciples kept urging him, one version says. They were respectful. Now, they were respectful. Master, teacher, rabbi. See, they were respectful. But they were asking Jesus to do something he just couldn't do at that time. That was all there was to it. They thought this was a good time. Those in the flesh don't understand those who are living for God. They really don't understand it. And you may try and explain it, but if you do, explain it like Jesus did, so they won't understand it anyway. Because you can't explain this to the satisfaction of a person who's head is nailed to the earth. You may make perfect sense to you, it may make perfect sense to you, but it doesn't to them. So Jesus just says, I got something to eat you don't know about. I have access to nourishment that you don't have any idea about it. They just let it drop right there. I have meat to eat you know not of. See, there's a form of nourishment that can strengthen both men, inner and outer, at the same time.
Yeah,
amen. Yeah, well, I don't know that that's true. Yes, that's true. You haven't forgot that Jesus fasted for 40 days and 40 nights without eating or drinking. Moses did it two times. Two times he fasted without eating or drinking for 40 days. Elijah went without eating for 40 days on the strength of an angelic prepared meal. See, the biologists and physicians would say that's impossible. you can't go without water more than 3 days.
Yeah, that's right.
See, but that's without supernatural.
That's right. Amen.
That's without the miraculous. That's not considering God. God can nourish both inner and outer at the same time. He won't do it while a person's immersed in the things of the world.
Yeah.
This will not happen.
That's right.
You'll die in 40 days.
Yeah.
God can sustain a person that miraculously, and that's what Jesus was living on, divine nourishment at this time. There were other times when he completed what he was going to do. And he said to his disciples, come ye yourselves apart into a desert place and rest a while. And see, this what he, on another occasion he said this. Let's go outside and rest a while. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat. It's Mark 6:31. Leisure means convenient time. It was so busy ministering, people coming and going. See, it wasn't Jesus. See, Jesus was the one that did the coming in our text. He's the one that went where he was.
That's right.
But our people, they were coming and going and didn't have any. But Jesus had finished what he was going to say. He finished what he was going to say to that multitude. He said, we got to go away now and rest for a while. And he withdrew. Sometimes he'd send them away. Now, probably unknown to the disciples, they themselves had been eating some of the food Jesus gave. They'd been with him while he was ministering, and they'd been sustained, but just they couldn't make the connection. Normally, you think of Jesus' ministry as output, huh? Output. But here Jesus tells you his ministry involved input as well as output. He was not only feeding, he was eating at the same time, feeding and eating at the same time. See, a personally sustaining ministry. If you're working for the Lord, there's sustainment in doing the work. Doing the work sustains you as well as allows you to output. Even him that was the full, in whom the fullness of the Godhead dwelt bodily, the fact that it was bodily, man, he had to have some inner nourishment.
Amen.
And he got his nourishment while he was ministering.
Yeah.
All right, now this flies right smack in the face of people that say you have to fast. Because God never said you had to fast. He didn't say you couldn't fast. I understand there's some things that call for fasting, but see, people think the only way you can get something from God is get away from everything else and try to get away from the work of God. So there's the famous sabbatical leave, which is a bunch of hogwash. I don't trust a man who has to take a sabbatical leave, I think, that's not the fellow I'm going to follow. I'm not going to condemn him. That's not my business, but I'm not going to follow him. There is a sabbatical, but it's an everlasting sabbatical. It's when you enter into his rest.
Yes,
see? So while Jesus was on earth, he hungered within as well as without. But some of the time, not all the time, sometimes he'd withdraw into a mountain to be alone. I understand that. But some of the times, while he was ministering, he was feeding at the same time. I have meat to eat.
Yeah.
You don't know anything about it. And so he didn't endeavor to explain it either, did he? But they did eventually come. They came to see this, eventually. Therefore said his disciples one to another, upon hearing these words, hath any man brought him aught to eat?
Yeah.
Very, very confusing to them.
That's very comforting when you consider you're never going to ever go to Jesus and he's going to say, sorry, I don't have any meat.
Yeah.
I have meat.
Yeah.
He has what we need.
Yeah.
But we do need to go to him.
Well, yeah, in this case here, you get it by doing his will.
That's right. Yeah.
See?
But it comes from him.
It comes from him, but it comes from while you're doing his will.
Uh-huh.
That's the eating we're talking about here.
Right.
There is a place where I understand you go to him, but this is not the norm. Mm-hmm. The norm isn't withdraw and go and eat. That's not the norm. The norm is do the work and eat while you work. That's the norm, and that's how Jesus was sustained.
Well, to say it a different way, you're never going to do his will and not be fed.
That's right.
Yeah.
See, though, this makes retirement look kind of absurd.
Yeah.
Doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Or else a man finishes his work a long time before he dies, which is kind of, who come up with that? See? So they didn't comprehend. Surely someone is... come in here and give him something to eat that we didn't know about. See, there's an area of reality that can't be known or diagnosed by human knowledge. There's this realm of knowledge and wisdom. It deals with things that are beyond the border of human experience. And human experience is limited to things that can be seen, heard, smelled, tasted, touched, and you can only know about things that fall in that category. You can only have knowledge or earthy expertise in things in that category. You get beyond that category, the best you can do is theorize, hypothesize, guess, conjecture, and all those terms. That's what people do. People trying to figure out how old the world is, and how they're just guessing. This is just guesswork.
That's right.
And why should you guess when God told you what happened?
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. That's why it's serious business.
Yeah.
You think the children are taught in school about the theory of evolution and all this, and they're given a lot of conjecture. You know, and you gotta if your children are in public school, you've got to offset that.
That's right. Yeah.
You got to offset that with sound instruction.
Yes.
Amen.
Otherwise, they'll grow up guessing about everything else, too. Mm-hmm. What men imagine concerning God and Christ and the world to come and the unseen world of spirits, the Word of God, what men think about these things independently of God cannot be trusted. No matter how long the string of degrees after their name. They can't be trusted. Whatever men have assumed or concluded about God or Christ or salvation or eternal life or heaven or hell or Satan, if it didn't come from God, you can't trust it. You should not subject your mind to it. Touch not the unclean thing.
That's right.
See?
Yeah. Amen.
See, we'll subject ourselves to it, and then we'll learn about its weak points. Well, you'll learn about its strong points, too. And someone stronger than you is promoting it. But in Scripture, we frequently read of this kind of limitation. They understood not. And I give you some text there. God did something. It may be perfectly clear to you, but the people that saw it, they didn't understand. They understood not. Now, holy men of God know about this circumstance. So David, quite a few times he said to God, give me understanding. See? That's why. That's why he said it, because he was advanced in thinking. His father was the wisest man of earth wisdom that has ever lived on the face of the earth. Solomon, he taught David all this, the lower realm. He taught him all that. But when it comes to the things of God, that wisdom didn't work. Solomon had all this wisdom, and he promoted idolatry. Filled his house with heathen wives. See? Because earth wisdom God's teaching you earth wisdom. You don't learn the things of God with this at all. So David prayed, give me understanding. And Paul, he'd pray for the churches. The churches, the ones that were in Christ, these people. He said that he was praying that God would give them the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, open the eyes to their understanding. He prayed this for one of the premier churches of the Bible, the church at Ephesus. He was there for 3 years. It's one of the premier, most advanced churches in the Bible. And he prayed for them that God would give them understanding. Colossians, same thing. He prayed that God would give them the spirit of wisdom and spiritual understanding. Why did they pray things like that? Because the things of God cannot be apprehended with natural resources.
That's right.
You can't teach a person. One person cannot teach a person how to lay hold of the things of God. It can't be done. It has to be done by God. Well, the disciples, they didn't know this. Now, here's a saying Solomon gave, which is very true. It could offend some people, but so be it. He said, of making many books, there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. Take it or leave it, that's the way it is.
Yeah.
Book people wear out.
Yeah.
Much study
yeah.
is a weariness of the flesh. So what about studying the Bible? Much study is a weariness of the flesh.
Uh-huh.
You got to attend, it's got to be attended with prayer and
yeah.
submission to God and
yeah.
faith. And if it's not, it's just worry, just wear you out.
Yeah.
Why? Because, see, this one world, you can't... You can't access this unseen world by resources from the lower world.
Yes. Yeah.
Doesn't work.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason the disciples did not understand wasn't because they were unintelligent.
That's right.
It wasn't because they were uneducated. It's because at this time they did not yet have spiritual understanding.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So they couldn't think this thing out, see? They tried to think this out, and they come up with, someone must have given him something to eat.
Yeah.
See, they did. They reasoned differently than they reasoned later.
Uh-huh.
This is before any of them were born again
mm-hmm.
or received the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
None of those two things had happened yet. They took place on the day of Pentecost, and after that, they never again talked like this.
That's right.
You'll never read any of them talking like this after that. They did not ponder the possibility that God could and probably did sustain Jesus at this time. They didn't think that. They didn't say, well, God must have sustained him. See? They didn't even think this way. But they did think this way later. Paul said, I know what it's like to go hungry. But he didn't die.
That's right.
He was sustained during that time. At this time, they thought the nourishment of the body was more important than the sustenance of the soul. Why did they think this way? Because it wasn't because they were stupid or rebellious. It's because their eyes of understanding hadn't been opened up. They did not yet have the ability to see into the realm above.
Yes, amen.
That would come, though. They couldn't reason this way. God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think. They didn't think this way because they couldn't think this way. Later on, they could.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, Brother Dan.
Thinking on that first point, in the meanwhile, thought about Noah's work. He had a long...
It's a meanwhile.
Yeah,
long
that's right. That's right.
But there's no word at all given about any... lack of diligence or lagging or slow or anything like that. He was actually given the whole story
mm-hmm.
before the work started.
Yeah.
This is what's going to happen. So that whole time of building, he had this understanding
that's
of
right.
how the end was gonna come out.
Mm-hmm.
So without the spiritual understanding, there's really not any sustenance to do any work.
Mm-hmm.
Or to maintain any any zeal or or diligence.
Amen.
Yeah.
And the one of the prophets said, "My people perish for lack of
knowledge."
Yeah.
Or lack of knowledge. Right?
Yeah, that was a long meanwhile.
Yes,
wasn't it?
It was. You know, you know how sometimes with a child or with someone you're training to do a certain position, it takes a certain amount of patience, because you have this if you know how to do it, you have this, well, you just have an expectation they need to do this, but they don't know it yet, and they have to learn and they have to grow. And this thing, Jesus said, "How long do I suffer you?" This was like, well, can't you see it? But see, he knew what they were going through. But God's long-suffering, he's patient, and he gives us a space to grow up, to mature.
That's right.
The day star rises, but then it is expected that you go on to perfection.
Yes, amen. See, salvation addresses this situation.
Yes.
Salvation fully addresses this situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you will live by faith and walk in the Spirit and live unto Christ, present your body a living sacrifice to God, you'll come. He'll bring you to the point where you can understand these things. If you don't, you just prolong the state of ignorance.
Yeah, that's right.
And it may run right up into the coming of the Lord, or you die. See, so the body of Christ has got to encourage people, get on the ball. Don't be dawdling around here and wasting your life away. Don't do it. Whatever excuse is presented to you by other people for doing this, just don't pay attention to it. This is true.
Will only give you so much time.
That's right.
To get with it. I mean, because it's costing him something, and actually, it's costing the kingdom for me to be stupid. I mean, I shouldn't say it like that. But see, as longer I am holding up the process, because God's willing to give you the understanding. Yeah, he says, "Let him ask of me; he'll give you the understanding." Yeah. But you got to be involved.
Yeah, you're contributing to a state of ignorance or a state of enlightenment. You're making a contribution to one of those. So if a person's dragging their feet and they're not seeking the Lord, they're pulling the whole generation down. Yeah, it just takes one Elijah. It doesn't take 1,000 Elijahs. It just takes one Elijah. That's all. Just take one John the Baptist. That's just say, well, just one Paul. That's one Peter. That's all it takes. It's somebody. Somebody will take hold, and then God can funnel whatever, all the power of heaven into that person. So they didn't understand because they didn't have spiritual understanding yet. But when they were born again, that situation was resolved.
Amen.
This is before any of them were born again or received the Holy Spirit. And other people talk about receiving Jesus into your heart and this sort of thing, asking Jesus into your heart, but they never talk about born again. That's not something you do.
Yeah, that's right.
That's something God does.
Amen.
He does it through your faith.
Amen.
And then he keeps you by your faith. That's how it is. So if your faith is weak, you've got no advantage. You don't. Jesus can make the weak person stand, but not like for a lifetime.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not his will. Now notice again how the disciples reason. They did not ponder the possibility that God could and did sustain Jesus. Now they knew about God giving manna to Israel. They knew about miraculous food. Miraculous sustenance. They knew about this widow that lived on one small barrel of meal and cruse of oil that never diminished. He took out of it every day and it never went down. They knew about this, but they couldn't correlate it with where they were. See, there are people technically they know what the Bible says, but they can't integrate it into life. They can't relate a sovereign God with living. That's what lack of understanding is, what it means not to understand. You can't take what is obvious to people living by faith.
Uh-huh.
They just can't bring it where they are and integrate it there. So they couldn't think of Jesus being nourished by something other than food, earthly food. They weren't able to discern that he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think. Nothing like this is ever reported of the apostles after they were born again and received the Holy Spirit. When they faced a lame man that asked for alms, they knew what to do. When they faced opposition, persecution, they knew what to do. Acts 4. When they faced confronted liars in the church, they knew what to do. When they confronted a sorcerer that had deceived an entire city, Peter and John, they knew what to do.
That's
right. See, they didn't have these questions. They didn't have these then, afterward. Within the framework of the new covenant, men are given to reason or think properly. You have to grow in this. I understand this. But we expect people that obey the gospel, we expect they're going to come to the point where they don't have to hear the ABCs recited over and over and over. They can think these things out. They don't have to get on the phone and call someone else up and say, what do I do? You know, they're able to know what to do. And they're able to do exploits. The people that know God, Daniel said, the people that do know their God will do exploits.
Yes.
When I have questions, they'll do exploits.
Yeah.
You know where the world is crying out for people that can do exploits. Know what to do. So now within the framework of the new covenant, we have access to all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. See? All the treasures of wisdom and knowledge, which are food for the soul. They're hidden in Christ. And you've been added to Christ. You've been joined to Christ. You've been called into Christ's fellowship. You're in Christ. You're baptized into Christ. And that's where all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are. So now you, given this situation, you are able to more and more be able to think properly. Sometimes I'm kind of overwhelmed by it, by how many questions professed Christians have. It's mind-boggling. Absolutely mind-boggling. If people didn't have all these questions, what would the counselors do? They'd have to get an honest job. That's what they'd have to do. See? You'd be surprised how many Christian enterprises there are that are devoted to answering people's problems. It's mind-boggling. We're not talking about a couple here and there.
Yeah.
This dominates the Christian world.
Yeah.
Except in the third world countries where they don't have anything, and there they don't. They just busy themselves with feeding the people earthy food and not spiritual food.
Yeah.
In this account that we're studying, we have an example of Christ leading someone in their thoughts.
That's right.
I was thinking about this as we had thought about the exchange between the woman and Jesus, and when she would ask the question and he would answer, he was leading her in her thinking by what he answered and the things he had her think about, the things that he opened up in her heart that she didn't even know he knew.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus teaches us how to think.
Amen.
But it's when we come directly to him. This woman had direct access to Christ himself.
Mm-hmm.
That's when we're learned, when we're taught, when we can learn how to think.
Amen.
Yeah.
And the point of this text is Jesus himself was fed when he was feeding her.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? I have meat to eat. He's feeding while he's feeding her.
Yeah, yeah. Amen.
Boy, that's some thought.
Yeah.
My meat, my food. Meat is a word for food in Scripture. My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. That's what satisfies me.
Yeah. Amen.
That's what gives me nourishment and strength. See, when Jesus was speaking to his disciples, he wasn't just talking to them. He was teaching and instructing them, and his teaching and instruction fed him as well as them on a deeper level. He was sustained while he was doing the will of the Father.
Yeah, amen.
See? In that activity, yes.
We've had a a taste of this whenever we're speaking to someone and they're receiving what we're saying and they're learning. Maybe we're able to teach them something. We've received the same kind of thing.
Amen. It sustains you.
That's
you're
right.
sustained in it, see? Who but God could do something like this?
I was thinking that too. Especially in the assembly, when you get up and you speak and you share the things you've learned, and you sit back down, you see more things too.
That's right. Yeah.
Because you were fed as well.
You had meat to eat.
That's right.
While you were feeding.
Yeah.
Yes.
How could the devil win in a situation like that?
That's right.
See, this gives all the advantage to the people of God. But see, they've got to know this, not to realize it. So Jesus said to them, he wasn't speaking to them as their friend. He was speaking to them as their teacher and master and leader. My meat or my food, my nourishment. He's testifying, see? He's testifying about himself. Not only who he is, but what nourishes him. So you've got to believe this. You've got to believe this, that when Jesus is teaching you, and he does teach us. Ephesians 4, 20 and 21 tells us that you've been taught by Christ. That when he's teaching you, he is also being nourished.
Yes, amen.
In other words, when he outputs, nothing diminishes.
Yeah.
When he outputs, there's an increase. The same as with you. When you pour out, then what you have increases.
Yes.
If you never pour out, you're just kidding yourself if you think it's going to increase. It's not. Just like that woman, the oil increased as she poured it out. That widow that filled up all the bottles with oil. As she poured out, the oil increased and maintained. The widow that fed Elijah through this long, lengthy famine, a small barrel of meal and a small cruse of oil, she ate out every day she took out of it, but it never went down. See? What a thought.
It's kind of like those new
wineskins. Yeah, that's right.
It's that are tender enough that they can expand. So as we're being poured out for the Lord, it's making this room for what the Lord's put in us to continue to grow.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
That's one of the functions of the new birth, is to make you growable. Expandable.
Mm-hmm.
That's why when you're born again, you're adapted to a kingdom that's on the increase. Of the increase of his kingdom, there shall be no end. See, so you're transported into this kingdom. It's in this constant state of expansion all the time. And so he's got to make you adaptable to that to that kingdom. So when you're born again, you can advance and grow and expand and increase. And you think in terms of that, getting more and more. See, that you're in the more and more category. Now my meat, my food, is to do the will of him that sent me. Now some versions, they misrepresent this. Some of the versions read this way. Some versions say to obey, to be obedient, doing what I should do. So my meat is to obey, and some versions read that way. To obey what God wants. That's what feeds me, is to obey. See, but this is not right. This is not a proper representation. The word used here, there is a word for obey in Scripture. There is a word. It's not this one. This is a different word. For those that do know the Greek language, it's poreo. And what it means, what the word itself means, is to fulfill or to do. It's not to obey. That's the wrong word here. It means to bring forth, to execute, to fulfill. To take a task that's been given to you and bring it to its fulfillment. That's doing. Doing something isn't some activity, you know. doing is accomplishing.
Amen.
It's fulfilling. Okay? Mm-hmm. Jesus said, this is my meat, is to fulfill,
yeah,
bring to completion,
uh-huh,
what God has given me to do.
Mm-hmm.
And anything else is not doing by divine definition.
Mm-hmm.
Doing is just not activity.
Yeah.
Going to church, mm-hmm, you know what? That's not what it is. It's finishing what you've been given to do.
Yeah, amen.
That's doing.
Mm-hmm.
Now, speaking of this, Jesus spoke about his works this way. He said, though ye believe not me, believe the works. That means these works are testifying to something, yes, God is doing.
Mm-hmm.
Believe the works that ye may know and believe that the Father's in me and I in him. How can you know the Father? By what he did, which is
right,
works.
Amen.
See,
mm-hmm,
the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Mm-hmm. Believe me that I am in the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake.
Mm-hmm.
It was works he was finishing, he was bringing to completion. It wasn't just activity,
yeah,
going about healing and so forth. That he did that, but
mm-hmm,
that's not what the works were he's talking about,
yeah,
here. He was finishing what God gave him to do. When he worked, the people were brought to a conclusion.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
People saw it, they saw these works and saw them, were brought to a, this is the Son of God. Mm-hmm. Yes, Brother Tony.
This is the filling up.
The filling
also
up,
that
baby
word is to, and
yes,
we
sir
talked about the other week, this is the, another form of the word, that filling up.
Fill it
it
up
has this idea,
mm-hmm,
of completion.
That's right.
God had something to be done, and Jesus is actually what he's talking about here is I'm filling this, I'm completing this work.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
That word too connotes being the author of something too.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
That he's beginning something,
mm-hmm,
and that's beginning with these disciples too.
So. Amen.
Yeah.
See, Jesus commenced his work that day. He stood up in the synagogue of his hometown,
mm-hmm,
and read that prophecy of Isaiah,
yeah,
about being appointed to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of prison to them that are bound and so forth. He said, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. That was the commencing.
Yeah, amen.
That commenced,
mm-hmm,
the work. And he finished what he was to do on earth.
Mm-hmm.
When he was praying in Gethsemane, he said, I finished the work,
mm-hmm,
you gave me to do. Last words he said on the cross was, it is finished.
That's
he
right,
he
yeah
wrapped up,
yep,
the earth part.
Amen. That's right.
Of his mission.
Mm-hmm.
The rest of it, he didn't finish it. All his work wasn't finished.
Mm-hmm.
Just what was to be done,
yeah,
on earth.
Amen.
He'd been working ever since then,
yeah,
from the right hand of God.
Amen. Yes.
He's finishing that. Now he's finishing the complete work. He's bringing the sons to glory, see? He's interceding for them.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that scripture whenever he read that. Can't you just, imagine the satisfaction beginning right there when
mm-hmm
he realized that he was doing that, or whenever he knew he was,
yeah,
he was going to be doing these things, and that
mm-hmm
all this time, this is what he's doing. He's getting ready to free the captives and
that's
all.
Right.
So,
that's
so
right.
That's mm-hmm the meat. I mean, he's like anticipating.
Yeah.
So he has this hope all along,
right,
all the way to the cross.
See, yeah, before he can commence the work in heaven,
yeah,
amen,
he's got to get this,
yep,
work done on,
amen,
earth, where the,
yeah,
people are made,
yeah,
workable.
That's right,
mm-hmm,
amen.
Yeah,
they're made growable.
That's right.
See,
yeah,
they got to be changed. They got to,
yep,
be adapted to this work he's going to do from heaven. Because he's not in heaven to change flesh.
That's right. Yeah.
That's,
yeah,
not what he's there for. He's there to bring us to glory, to get us through the world,
uh-huh,
unscathed.
Yeah, pretty soon we're going to hear the words, it is done.
It's,
yeah,
done.
And that's going to, you know, usher in a new,
yeah,
a new era, one where this salvation will be completed, but yet they'll still be, we'll enter into the next,
yeah,
phase of it. You know, you don't give an apprentice the kind of work you give to a craftsman.
Yes.
You just don't do it. It would be foolish.
Yeah.
The outcome would be would be a travesty. I mean, you wouldn't get the product,
yeah,
you're looking for. Neither does Jesus.
So as you advance, he gives you more to do, because you can do more.
And this, everything you do in the world for God is preliminary.
Yes, that's right.
None of it is the final stage.
Yes.
It's all preliminary.
Yeah.
You have been appointed in Christ to reign with Christ.
Amen.
You've been appointed to be a joint heir with Christ. Christ has inherited all things, and he said to the churches, he that overcometh will inherit all things. So that's where you're headed.
Amen.
But it's commencing now. It's commencing now, and just like Jesus found personal sustenance in doing the will of God here, you will find personal sustenance when you are doing the will of God here.
Amen.
If you don't do the will of God here, you are not being sustained.
Yeah, amen. Amen.
You're in a dangerous position.
Mm-hmm.
You're in a position where you got to wake up.
Mm-hmm.
Awake, thou that sleepest, see?
Confidence in working for Christ, because here he says it's God that was doing the work.
Yeah.
The Father's doing the work. You're involved, but as you walk in the Spirit, you can have confidence because God's in you working both
that's
the will
right.
and the do.
Amen.
So he's really the one that's making the things effective, but you're doing the work, but he's making it effective.
Amen. This is why getting people into the kingdom is not the fundamental work. It's the initiation of the work. It's the commencement of the work. But nobody is safe at last till they're in glory with Jesus. And until you are with Jesus in the glory, the work is still going on. It's not finished yet. And the devil has brought this emphasis, I'm persuaded, to bring them in and then just, they'll grow up by themselves. Well, they won't grow up by themselves.
No.
The solemn commission is feed the flock of God.
Yeah. Amen.
That's what leaders in the body of Christ are told, feed the flock of God.
Mm-hmm.
Feed the church of God. Which he's purchased with his own blood. That's a solemn injunction now from the king. Why? Because you yourself will be sustained as you do the will of God. It's in doing. See, Jesus, his the food he ate it while he was doing God's will. Doing God's will fed him as well as those he ministered to. As you do the will of God, you will be fed in the doing of the will.
Yes.
That's what will feed you.
Amen.
I trust everybody can see that. I know that Christ's personal involvement in the will of God brought joy, satisfaction.
Uh-huh.
It was all included in that. And
uh-huh.
My meat is to do his will and to finish.
Yeah.
To finish his work. He finished the earth part of the work. He's finished. He's not coming back to earth to wrap up some more work here.
That's right.
Amen.
I'm sorry, people teach that are just dead wrong. That's all there is to it. They're wrong. They're not right.
Uh-huh.
Jesus has finished. What he's going to do on earth is finished.
That's right. Amen.
That's it.
Amen.
And now he's finishing what's the wrap-up work in heaven. Which requires his intercession for you. You can't go to heaven without an intercessor.
Amen.
You got to have one. That's a yea rather ministry. Romans 8:34 says he gave himself for us. Yea rather intercedes. See,
that's
a rather ministry. That he's doing from heaven. He's mediating the covenant, taking the benefits you need from heaven and giving them to you. See, that's what he's. What he's doing now, and he's bringing us to glory.
Yeah.
Many say he's bringing us through quite a morass of evil and difficulty, but he's bringing us, that's finishing the work.
Amen.
So that means to me that Jesus takes great delight in this. This is personally
Amen.
Very delightsome to him to perfect the work. as I mentioned to you, before he got ready to lay down his life, he said to his father, I have finished the work that you gave me to do. His last words from the cross, it is finished. Now the phrase finished work of Jesus, that's not in the Bible. People use this phrase, this phrase is not in the Bible because his work isn't finished. Just what he was to do on earth is finished. That's all that was finished, what he was to do on earth. Intercession wasn't finished, mediation wasn't finished, bringing sons to glory wasn't finished, giving the Holy Spirit wasn't finished. He did all that after he got back.
Amen.
Didn't pour forth the Spirit on all flesh while he was here, he was while he was there, see? So he went there to finish the work. But my point here is that he personally delights in this work of finishing the work. I can imagine there's tremendous joy and satisfaction he receives when he intercedes for us, or keeps us from falling, or causes us to stand, or gives or teaches us, or Jesus is personally affected by what he does for the Lord. He's just not obeying the law. That's why those words obey, that Jesus did not just obey, he was obedient. I understand that. He was obedient in laying down his life, but more was involved in obedience. He desired to do this. With desire I've desired. See, he desired to do this. He wanted to do this, and that's what nourished his. So you've got to see this. You've got to see this, that when you personally want to do God's will, you will be strengthened by that want. That want will actually feed your soul.
There's a certain hunger.
That's right.
Jesus is talking about that hunger.
That's right.
Satisfying with the meat.
There's an aspect of nourishment that you can't get unless you're doing the will of God and fulfilling his good will like Jesus did. So when Jesus, he intercedes for us, he gives us an understanding. We know the Son of God has come and given us an understanding. I don't know if we would say Jesus is happy, if you in the most exalted sense. Jesus is very glad to give you what he has. Just makes him glad to do this. Very satisfying to him, to the Savior to do this, just as it was when he was on earth. You find great pleasure in it. He takes great delight in ruling in your favor.
That's right. Yes.
Amen. Makes the devil mad, but Jesus, he's glad when he does this.
Right.
When you comprehend what Jesus has said, you'll be given a place at his table. He will give you what he has to give you. If you delight in the Lord, he'll give you the desires of your heart. Even the psalmist knew that. But he's got more to give now than he did in the days of the psalmist.
Yes.
Very limited what he could give until Jesus took away sin.
Yeah.
Till he reconciled the world to himself and bruised the head of the serpent, defeated the serpent, spoiled principalities and powers. See, until he did that, there was a limit on what he could do for men.
Yeah.
But he did do that. And there's no limit now.
Amen.
You can limit him by not wanting him, because he won't stuff these things down your throat. That's not how he made man.
Amen.
But he's told you enough about what his intentions are that you should really want what he has.
Yes, amen.
Because he has good intentions for his people. He has good intentions for them.
Yes.
So when you comprehend what Jesus has said here, I have meat to eat you know not of. When you comprehend that, it takes the tediousness out of living. His commandments, they're not grievous. Do I have to do that again? This just isn't the way you talk.
Yeah, that's right.
It takes all the hardship out of it. His yoke is easy and his burden is light. When you keep the commandments of God, they're not. Now, he gives you some pretty tough commandments, like love not the world.
Yeah.
You think maybe he doesn't mean that?
Uh-huh.
Huh? touch not the unclean things. He gives you some commandments.
That's right.
Perfect holiness in the fear of God. Be ye separate, saith the Lord. See? But when he says that, it doesn't hurt you. You say, well, Lord, if you said to do this, then you'll give me the power to do it. And quite frankly, I do want to do it. And it takes the grief and the tediousness, and it just takes all that out. And as Brother Justin quoted there, his yoke is easy and his burden is light. The yoke is easy because it's a custom fitted yoke.
Yes,
see, it doesn't chafe.
Yeah.
It doesn't chafe you. Law chafes you.
Uh-huh.
Hard yoke to bear.
Yes.
Paul referred to it as a yoke that neither we nor our fathers were able to bear.
That's right.
It was just God demanded more of you than you could give.
Uh-huh. Yes.
That's what law does. It doesn't back up. Doesn't back up. You got to do it. And you've got this one chance to do it.
You know, the law was a one-size-fits-all.
That's right, that's right.
In Christ, we have grace.
And you weren't in the yoke, and God wasn't in the yoke with you.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. You had to pull it by. You had to pull the load yourself.
Uh-huh.
That's what saved by works means. See, it means you do it yourself.
That's right.
Well, we learned both by experience and by doctrine. We gotta have a Savior.
Amen.
One that's with us all the time. One that intercedes for us. One that we have regular access to all the time.
Amen.
And so the good news is you have one, and he delights in his ministry.
Yes.
It's his meat.
Amen.
His meat. He's nourished by it. Anyone else have something to... Yes, Brother Judah?
Not only do we have grace under the new covenant, it says somewhere that we're fellow laborers with Christ.
Yeah.
So that's on top of grace. But I kept thinking when you were speaking of finishing his work, Jesus finishes the work of the Father and to do the will of him that sent me, thought we are blessed with all spiritual blessings in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And those who deny Christ, whether or not they deny Christ through ignorance, or it's a knowing denial, they walk away from a feast. Christ has a lot to give.
Yeah.
And he's willing to give it as well. That's unstoppable. He has a lot to give, and he wants to give it to you if you want what he has.
That's right.
This is a widespread feast. If you take somebody who hasn't eaten in a couple of days, so they're hungry, you show them a massive table spread with all sorts of food that they like. Are they going to walk away from it and say, no, I don't need anything if they haven't eaten in, fill in the blank, they haven't eaten in a while? They're going to eat something from the table because it's available and they can have it. This is what we do with Christ. Christ is available. The knowledge that he has is available if you're willing to get it. And he's willing to give it.
That's right.
And we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in Christ. That leaves no stone unturned.
And then let's add this too, that these things are given to us to finish our work.
That's right. Yeah.
These blessings are not ends of themselves.
We're supposed to be confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Christ.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Amen.
You talked about the meanwhile time period at the beginning of your lesson. But the meanwhile period is the period between the time the work has been initiated and the time the work has been completed.
That's right.
See, and so that's why I'm so thankful for the emphasis on finishing the work, just starting it, because there's the danger during this meanwhile time of being distracted.
Yeah.
See, this could have been a distraction to Jesus, because this work in Samaria wasn't done yet.
Mm-hmm.
And so this could have presented a distraction for him. And so I'm thankful for the testimony of Jesus here. It's to be a good and faithful servant is to complete the work.
Amen.
And that's why it's such a wonderful blessing to find satisfaction while you're in the work.
Amen.
Because that'll keep you to the work
until
it's been completed.
Amen. That's right.
Now the purpose is to finish the race. If you don't finish the race, then you ran in vain.
That's right.
Yes, Brother Matt.
I was thinking that too, that there's a sense in which that the space of time between when Jesus went up in heaven and now is like, or in that the end of the world is like the mean time.
Mean time.
And,
yeah.
If he was faithful to with his mean time while he was in the earth, you can be confident that now he's going to be faithful in the meantime.
That's right. Yeah. See, in the meantime, God's faithful, Jesus is faithful, yeah. Spirit's faithful, yeah. Angel's faithful.
Yes.
The only thing in question is the people.
Yes.
That's the only. That's the only questionable factor, and they're given all the resources
that's, right.
that's needed to handle this meanwhile,
yes.
to handle it profitably, and to finish your course with joy.
And God says, my people shall be willing in the day of my
power. That's right.
Yeah.
You know, some of the things you said about these things not being known or having to be opened up, because it said they knew not what he meant. And what he was talking about was something that was just beyond what they could perceive,
uh-huh.
actually. And spiritual things, they're too big for natural senses to comprehend.
Yeah.
Like even the concept of God, men can't wrap their mind around that because that's beyond their boundary of knowledge. Senses, it's bigger than that. So like, with that being said, if something spiritual is opened up, you've been shown something big.
Mm-hmm.
It shouldn't be taken lightly or disregarded if God opens something up to you. I mean, it's not something small.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes, Brother Tony.
I like he was talking about Jesus personally delighted in doing the work and finishing it,
mm-hmm.
or desired. Desire leads to perfection.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. I want to make one more comment. In case some miss this, it is true as Brother Bob has said that thy people are willing in the day of thy power, and that Jesus said, all that the Father give me will come to me. But those are explanations to people for whom this has happened. When you read these texts, if you're not willing, don't be reading Psalm 2 about people being willing in the day of his power. Because you're living in the day of his power. You're living in the day of his power.
Yes.
See? If you're not coming to Jesus, don't sit back and say, well, the Lord will draw me.
That's right.
That's not why that's there.
That's right.
Not why those texts are there. Those texts are there to explain
yes.
to the person. It's a sin not to want to come to God.
Yes. Yeah. Amen.
Because you've been appointed to do this.
Yes.
He's established the times and the places
yes.
that all people occur on earth,
mm-hmm.
that they might seek the Lord and feel after him, if happily they might find him. So the appointment of every person, whether they know it or not,
yeah.
is to seek after God.
Yeah.
Nobody who seeks will not find.
That's right. Amen.
Jesus said, all who seek,
uh-huh.
find.
Yep.
To all who knock, it shall be opened.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when that happens, now, these explanations,
yes.
it wasn't really you.
Uh-huh. Amen.
It was God that did, it was really God that did all the work,
yes.
even though it looked like you were the one that did it,
yeah.
because you did enter into it.
Yes. Yeah.
But see, God was only God could manage such a complex
Amen.
Thing as a person.
Amen. That's right. That's right.
Yeah, Brother Abe.
Say that this passage has always amazed me, because here are the Samaritans, people that the Jews have been taught to look down on, you know, so strongly, even worse than Gentiles almost, you know. And yet Jesus in this passage is saying, you know, man is not to live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. He stayed there two more days, I think.
Yeah, 2 days.
And
yeah.
so he's sitting there, and he is saving them. He's pouring his life out for them. The disciples don't realize how much, but he's sharing them the gospel. And I just think that so often we are like the disciples. We don't see the amazing work that God can do to the people around us, and Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
There is good to fast and pray for people around us, and to try to prioritize the things that are important.
Yeah, Jesus went there to get some other sheep, but he forbade, when he first sent his disciples out, he told them not to go to the Samaritans. Right? He said, go not in this, don't go there. When he first sent them out, Matthew 10. But see, they couldn't reason with it. This didn't mean he had no interest there. It meant it wasn't time yet.
That's right. Yeah.
That's all it meant. It wasn't time yet.
Uh-huh.
Now the time.
That's right.
It was time.
Mm-hmm.
There was a harvest. No, there was a harvest to be reaped.
Yes.
He saw it. They didn't see it at the time. Yeah.
How calculating God has done these things. Everything was calculated and appointed.
Yeah.
See,
uh-huh.
It wasn't haphazard. We're gonna go here today and tomorrow, but these things were appointed.
Yeah, when you receive enough, and the scriptures tell you enough about divine direction that you know that there's times and seasons in God's power.
Yeah.
There was a time when it wasn't time to preach to Asia. It was not time.
Mm-hmm.
So the Holy Spirit said no. There was a time, it wasn't time to go to Bithynia.
Yeah.
There was a time during Jesus' ministry when it wasn't time to go to Samaria.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But this time it was the time.
That's right.
There were some people there to be reaped, some of his flock
uh-huh.
that were not of the Jewish fold.
Yeah.
Remember Jesus said, I have other sheep that are not of this fold.
Yeah.
Some of them were there. It wasn't everybody. It wasn't all Samaritans.
Yeah, that's right.
But there were some there, and he went there to reap. To reap those souls.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Those spiritual desires are more deeply satisfying than the desires of the body.
Good. Yeah.
It's like, you know, when Job talked about, I think it was Job that talked about desiring God's word more than is necessary.
Necessary food.
Yeah. And so actually that is the secret to keeping under your body.
Yeah.
Is to actually have this greater and more fulfilling satisfaction
yeah.
so that you're not
right.
driven by carnal desires.
That's right.
And that's I think what we have here. I don't know whether Jesus was still hungry or not. It wasn't even an issue with Jesus because this greater thing was being fulfilled.
You know, it doesn't say that the woman never gave him the drink he asked for.
Yeah,
that's
right?
Yeah.
So apparently neither one of them were thirsty either. Yes, Brother Jonathan.
Something that ministers to me about this desire to do the will of God is how it can enable a person to rise above moments of fatigue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like in times of weariness when you normally would drop, the desire to do the will of God will actually cause you to almost forget about that fatigue and just press
That's
on.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Regardless, I mean, in times where normally a person would stop or rest, the will of God can drive a person beyond that point.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. If any of you have actually been living for God, you've already experienced some of this when your desire to God superseded
yeah.
natural desires. So you don't have to apologize to anybody. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is also why it's important as you grow up into Christ to know what your function is.
Uh-huh.
Because
yeah,
when
good.
You're doing what the Lord gave you to do, what your function in the body is, when you're fulfilling what the Lord gave you to do, the desire that you have, that's the most satisfying thing that we ever experience in this
yes.
life.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. And that's what sustains us until we do
yes.
leave.
Remember in the early church there when Barnabas uh-huh. had some property and sold it? I think he wanted to do that and got a great deal of delight out
yes.
of doing it. Where Ananias and Sapphira didn't affect them that way at
no.
all. Huh?
Yeah.
All right, I think we'll close there.